space, the boundary of human achievement, the new frontier.
It's just a cough.
Yeah, right. And the earth is flat.
Treat your cough seriously with Robitussin CF Max. Nothing lasts longer and treats more symptoms for your cough, cold, and flu. Robitussin, because it's never just a cough.
In a few moments, you will have an experience which will seem completely real. It will be the result of your subconscious fears transformed to your conscious awareness. Warning, this tape must not be played by government personnel. It can be extremely harmful and result in severe trauma. You have 5 seconds to terminate this tape. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
The world's still round. I'm here to tell you it's not. It's flat.
Lexi, tell us something interesting.
Okay, the earth is flat. And a witch stole his pants.
Flat Earth expert Mark Sargent thinks the moon landing was a hoax.
Technically, the moon itself is a hoax.
Right, but betting with Sportsbet's new iPhone app?
I could do this standing on my head.
Thanks, Gravity. Sportsbet's new iPhone app. It's foolproof.
Oh, hold on. I know how we're different. Do you believe the Earth is flat?
I know it's flat. I walk on it.
Holy shit.
The earth is flat,
it's a flat world after all.
Smoke weed every day.
Broadcasting straight to you from a large spaceship currently at war with mainstream science. Meanwhile, the peanut gallery is still embedded with the Ukraine legions over in Europe. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Strange World, where the truth is often stranger than fiction. I'm your host, Mark Sargent, the creator of Flat Earth Clues, which propose that all of us are living inside a Truman Show enclosed structure thousands of miles wide. Just Google Flat Earth Clues. If you can't find it, well, you're just not very good at the internet. Currently, this show is on Tuesday nights at 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern, and yes, Caroline, if it is not March 29th, 2022, then you are listening to a rerun, or maybe you're listening to an archive from the near future. Quote of the day goes exactly like this one thing. This is from Israel, by the way. I'm going to give you who it was ahead of time. The United States-Iranian agreement was sold disingenuously to the American public as an arms control agreement. The deal is an assault on the regional order that the United States established in the aftermath of World War II. Explicitly hostile to Saudi Arabia, to say nothing of America's other greatest ally in the region, Israel. It replaces the former American-led regional security structure with a concert system in which Iran, backed by Russia and China, become America's new subcontractors, while America's former allies, the Gulf states and Israel, are demoted to second-tier status. I know that sounds kind of boring, but it'll mean a lot more as we press on. My co-host, she's lovely, she's sassy, and she's one of the biggest Flat Earth rock stars ever, the wonderful Karen B. What's going on, Karen?
Hey, Mark. You know, just having the best apocalypse ever.
Right on. And it's only going to get better as
we move forward.
Hey, speaking of that, if you had to recommend one app for people to get while they still can in these early stages of the Great Reset, what would it be?
What would be the Flat Earth Sun, Moon, Zodiac, and Clock app?
Yes, indeed. It's the perfect gift for friends, family, and complete strangers. Watch the featured video every day for 2 weeks and see what happens. It'll be the best $2.99 you've ever spent. I'm not very good. I can't snap my fingers. I can't just crack them like other people. I mean, it's amazing other people. It should be just all bones, not you. You're good. Don't forget, you can also find this program on BitChute and Brady on Rockfim and Rumble. YouTube is not the end of Flat Earth. It is just the beginning. Shout outs, obviously, to Flat Earthers Stephen Carpenter of the Deftones, who are going on tour real soon.
That's
They're going to start in Portland. Second stop's going to be in Seattle. I am hoping to meet him up there. I know he's got a few days left over before he comes back down to the Bay Area in San Francisco. So love to hook up with him before, after the show. I don't really care. Either way, it's going to be groovy. Support the Flat Earth cause and get the coolest hoodies ever. Go to thestrong.family. Buy something, will you? Also, who else is supporting this show? Oh, it's truthsmacks.com with possibly a QR code on the screen, spreading truth one delicious morsel at a time. Truthsmacks. This is Trail Mix Supreme. It's got all sorts of good stuff in it, and I love it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's get to the meetups. I put in my notes
Absolutely
here.
Absolutely the best.
Is very, very good. Meetups. Let's do the New York one first. There's going to be a Flat Earth New York meetup April 2nd. It is from noon to whenever. You can see the promo for it on my channel. It's the Flat Earth meetup, New York City, April 2nd.
Mm-hmm.
Also, there are several more. There are two. There's going to be with Jesse because he drives all over the place. Let's see. Sunday, April 3rd from 6:30 until 9 at Black Dog Bar and Grill, 146 Park Road, Putnam, Connecticut. RSVP by calling Jesse at 857-344-6209, or you can email him at 300kmileprius@gmail.com. He will have an Icon P1000 with him. Also, he's doing a second one. It's going to be April 16th, but I'm going to read it anyway. Truther Chloe and he will be hosting a meetup Saturday, April 16th, all day at the Hummingbird Beach in Lake Ifala State Park in Oklahoma. Come early, stay late. It's going to be a lot of cool stuff. Same sort of thing. Call them at the number I read earlier. Or you can call Chloe at 405-614-2250. Or you can email her at chloerebecca@gmail.com. That's chloerebekah@gmail.com. Oh, sorry. One more. Jeez. All you people want meetups. The Florida meetups. There are three meetups happening this weekend in Florida. They are St. Petersburg, Palm Bay, and Miami. The schedules can be found at flatearthfestivals.com.
That's right, flatearthfestivals.com. Go to the Flat Earth Friendly Meetups tab at the top. Also, there is a meetup in Myrtle Beach, April 30th, put on by Brian Stavely and Christian Knapp, which the info for that is also at flatearthfestivals.com.
Right on. Okay, we are going to do only one section of headlines this segment. We're going to finish up with the headlines. The second segment, we're going to bring in U.S. Army Master Gunner, retired Brian Burton, because things are getting interesting, and I'm going to explain why. So we're going to run through these headlines real fast, and I'm going to hit you with a whole bunch of information, but we will also delve into it, and we'll expand on it a little more in the second segment. But yeah, things are getting, even though the news is filled with all sorts of fun distractions, which we're not going to talk about, there's some things happening behind the scenes which you really should be paying attention to. It's the stuff they're not telling you. And we are going to break it to you first here. Okay, so first, let's do a quick recap, which is the first headline. Last week on Strange World, we were sanctioning Russia, which created a financial world war. This is from Quartz. And that's all we're going to say about it. That was last week. In 1 week's time, this is what happened, which is why the show is called the PetroRuble. You're saying, why does that sound familiar? Well, because it used to be the petrodollar. Now, it hasn't been replaced yet. And for real quick for you guys, I want to preface this with facts you should know, which is the reason why this is important is that up until, which will be happening in 2 days, all oil has been trading in American dollars. All of it. And you're realizing, why? How'd that happen? It's like, well, because we said so. The Americans started running a protection racket after World War II, where we said, you know what? We see the value of oil, so let's just make it easy and have everyone trade in dollars. And people say, why are we trading dollars? Why don't we do multiple currencies? It's like, well, because we're America. And if you don't trade in dollars, bad things will happen. Okay? So, second headline, Russia sets... And again, I highly encourage people to spend more time at rt.com, which is called russiatoday.com, because eventually this website will be gone. Guarantee it. So learn what you can from what other people say about us. So from rt.com, Russia sets ruble gas payment deadline, which is where I also stole one of the – this is a kind of a different one. Oh, I kind of like that one, the thumbnail picture. So starting Thursday – Russia is going to only sell oil and gas. Well, they're going to start with gas and transition over oil. We'll see if they go with wheat and all the other minerals. They're only going to sell it in rubles. So what's that mean? It means you have to, if you want to buy gas from them, you have to take your dollars and or euros. And honestly, euros is NATO, so it might as well be dollars. You have to do a currency transfer, an exchange rate, and transfer them to rubles, and then they get paid in rubles. Okay. Why is this important? Let's go to the next headline. Next headline is also on RT. What buying gas in rubles means for Russia in the West. Now, we're not going to read this article. I'm just letting you guys know it's there because this is part of this is going to be Russian propaganda because they're only going to soft sell it. I'm going to give you a little section I wrote, not very long, maybe 60 seconds. So this is what the article basically says. The Russian central bank pegged rubles to gold. They've kind of done their own poor man's gold standard, which we used to be on years ago. Whole nother story for another time. Russia declared that they would only sell oil and gas in rubles. And by the way, forgive me if I say rubles every once in a while. I grew up thinking it was rubles. It's not the rupee. It's R-U-B-L-E-S, although you can spell it R-O-U-B-L-E-S, but it's a B, not a P. This means Russian oil and gas are pegged to gold with rubles as the proxy for gold. Europe, that needs Russian gas and oil a lot, will now have to buy rubles from Russia using gold or pay for the oil and gas with gold itself. Currently, the Forex rate for rubles to dollars is about 100 to 1. It doesn't mean the dollar is really powerful against the ruble. Rubles is considered cents. They don't have a dollar. It's like our coins. We say 10 cents, 99 cents, but when we get to 100 cents, we call it a dollar. When they get to 100 rubles, they just call it 100 rubles. So it's basically the same thing. With 5,000 rubles now equaling 1 gram of gold and oil being priced directly in gold, we're going to see a large price disruption in Forex markets in terms of how much gold a dollar can still buy. Foreign countries holding U.S. dollar debt notes in reserve, our dollars, will see an immediate and far less use for them and will want to start reducing them in favor of something more stable, something which holds its value. Basically, any currency pegged to gold will be a likely candidate, which means countries like, oh, I don't know, let's say Japan, will start reducing their dollar debt quickly. They will move into more stable currencies, which, because it's now backed by gold, is the ruble. This will have a deflationary effect on the ruble, making it more valuable over time. This also means Russia can repeg the ruble anytime they want to 500 or 50 or 10. If they keep playing their cards right, the value should just keep rising. The instant result is that all those foreign countries reducing their dollar reserves will cause all those excess dollars to start heading back our way. triggering ever-increasing inflation, because the more currency you have, the more dollars are actually here, the worse inflation gets. All right, that's the end of that part. All right, let's move down to the next article, because, again, all this, we're going to hit you with a lot of things, but it's going to make sense as we keep going. So what was the result of this? European Union said, yeah, we're not going to do it. We're not going to pay for your gas with rubles. And of course, they don't want to say that, but Americans are sitting over their head with a big sledgehammer saying, you better do what we tell you. You just can't cave in. And so Moscow's going, oh, fine, we'll just shut off the pipeline. That's what we'll do. And then what are you going to do? Especially Germany. Germany's whole industry sector, forget about heating homes, all their heavy gas turbines, they're run off gas. And you shut those off, their factories shut down. That's not a good thing. All right, so EU says no. Moving on to the next one down. And then there's other stories like this from the Huffington Post. This is over on our side. Why Europe cannot afford to cut off Russian energy. Well, that's really weird, because they just said they were willing to cut off Russian energy. And the Huffington Post says, yeah, they can't do it. No, they cannot. They cannot do it. Europe is absolutely tied to the gas and oil from Russia. All right, next one down. Trying to punch through these because we have 13 minutes of the break. The Qatar kicks in. And this is from RT, says replacing Russian gas is impossible. And what they mean by that is when you cut off, so Europe's energy needs are like between 40% and 50%, that's conservative, supplied by Russia. If Russia cuts, if they shut off the shipments of that energy, they've got to get it from somewhere. And countries like Qatar saying there's nowhere to get it from. And America, for example, let's move to the next one down. I know we're kind of speeding through these. It's like a speed run of, so not Qatar, we're doing the, oh yeah, EU. Okay, this is also from Russia Today. The European Union, although we're talking about it over here, EU strikes deal to buy gas from the U.S. So the Europeans are like, okay, so we'll not use the rubles. We won't buy the gas from Russia. What are you going to do for us, United States? United States, we have a lot of natural gas right now. It's like, oh, we'll start sending ships. We'll send ships your way. It'll be fine. You can send all the ships you want, but ships are no match for a pipeline. So even our ships going at max, we're maybe going to be able to replace 8%, 9% of what they need. To where Germany, and I'm not even going to print this article, it's out there though, you can find it. To where Germany's like, well, start breaking out the sweaters and cold weather gear, because you're going to have to get warm. And it's like, yeah, that's fine. What are you going to do about other places? Like, I don't know, buildings and assisted living facilities and stuff like that. What are you going to do there? So you know, United States is saying, oh yeah, we can absolutely, we're trying to downplay the magnitude of this. We're saying, oh yeah, we'll sell you all sorts of natural gas. We can't meet their needs. It's not going to happen. Moving on.
What about the Middle East?
No, they won't be able to do it. Oh, okay. Well, we're getting to that part. Okay, so the next fact, wonderful timing, Karen, because the very next article. This is from the Jerusalem Post. And the Jerusalem Post, this is part of the quote I read in the beginning, which is Israel is not happy with this whole situation. Here's why. So we need to get more oil and gas. So who did we turn to? The United States. Because remember, we're orchestrating this whole thing. This is all us. We're the ones that started the sanctions. We're the ones that are trying to shuffle things around, trying to hurt Russia. It's not working. So what we're going to Iran, and we're cutting a deal with Iran for more oil. And we're saying, yes, so I know you guys are thinking about developing advanced weapons facilities and, you know, bad things have been happening to them. We're going to totally help you with that. You're fine. Right. We're going to build, you know, I don't care if you don't believe in atomic weapons or not. They're helping them with advanced weapons. We'll just say that. And Israel's like, Iran hates us. And if you help them build advanced weapons, they're going to use them on us. It's like, oh, no, it'll be fine. Totally fine. We got this covered, because all we want is their oil. Iran used to be the bad guys. Remember that? Mm-hmm. So scroll down this article here real fast. I want to show you something. This is a little thing, a little story that's been swept under the rug. So Saudi Arabia, there was a petroleum facility that blew up recently. saying, well, that's weird. And one of the funniest quotes was, it's like, oh, it's because it was blown up by the, I remember the Saudi Arabia petroleum. It was blown up by some Iranian backed rebels. Uh-huh. Okay. So that plant blowing up, that had nothing to do with Saudi Arabia talking to the Chinese about selling oil in Chinese money. Had nothing to do with that. What you guys do not understand here, and we will, Brian Burton, Master Gunner, he's going to confirm this for me, is the United States has something very quiet behind the scenes. We have a zero tolerance policy for anyone even messing with our petrodollar. Zero tolerance. So Saudi Arabia even talks to the Chinese about going off the dollar, and a plant blows up, right? It's like, it's that straight out of organized crime movie. It's like, that's a nice petroleum factory you got there. It'd be a shame if something happened to it. You know, one of those deals, right? But imagine that on a country level. Say, a fine country you got there. Shame if something happened to it. That's the sort of level we have. It's not like taking out a little corner shop on a block. This is what we do. And so Saudi Arabia is freaking out because it's like, so what was the running joke? When you hear the term, feel free. If you ever hear the term Iranian backed, just replace that word with CIA. That's all you have to do, because we do that. Any country that goes against the petrodollar is bombed. Are you some kind of people out there listening, figuring out the connecting the dots here? Because one of the big kids on the block just stepped out into the street and challenged the petrodollar. He says, yeah, we're going to do one of our own. Just tapping his stick on the ground, calling you out. Oh, boy. Okay. So how much time I got left? Got a little time left. So that's the preface for the second segment. Let's get into the lucky and unlucky list really fast, because these are things you got to – that crisis is still not going away for all the people that you know, friends and family and coworkers that you know that got the shot. So first thing any doctor will tell you is, if you have a heart condition or if you had a heart issue, a heart attack or myocarditis or whatever, pericarditis or whatever carditis it is, first thing they'll tell you is, you know what? You should just stop strenuous activity entirely. Just don't do it anymore. It's really a bad idea. You don't want to overwork your heart. So first one, and I know you can say, well, wrestling isn't really a sport. No, it's not. But these guys do work hard. They work up a sweat, you know, this guy right here, WWE legend, he had a heart attack and he decided, you know what? It was in fact last September, go figure. And, also was dealing with viral pneumonia. Don't know where that came from. It's a mystery. And he just retired. He said, yep, I'm out. He listened to the doctors and he said, I'm out. He just quit, which is what you can do. Again, he's B-list, he's C-list. You know, that's just sort of the thing. It's a quiet article. It just goes away. The next one down, however, is more interesting, which is, if you're high profile enough right now, they're basically instructing you not to talk about it at all. So the number one female tennis star in the world just retired at age 25.
Right. Wow.
For no reason at all. Just say, oh, I've done what I need to do in tennis. It's like, are you kidding? And you got to remember, most of your tennis stars are groomed by their parents. They have a long-term plan for them, huge endorsements, huge, you know, play into their 30s at least, you know, plus you have the tours after that. I mean, you can just keep playing. Then you go into sportscasters. No, at 25, she just walked away. Why? Well, because the doctor, again, we're seeing this, by the way, over in Europe with soccer people. Soccer stars are retiring because they're not shy. It's like, oh, I've got some weird heart issue. I'm just going to quit at 31 and 32 and whatever it is. No, she's 25. Mm-hmm. Moving on. Still got a couple more to go before the break. So if you listen to the doctors when they tell you got myocarditis, again, look, if you have an inflamed heart, you probably should listen to what they're saying. But other people, they don't. They're like, you know what, I'm just gonna go, you know, ride or die, we're gonna play this thing out to the end. So I'm trying to be delicate with this one. If you guys missed it because of, you know, the Oscars, the lead drummer, longtime drummer for the Foo Fighters, Taylor Hawkins,
died. And depending on, they're trying to blame it on drugs, of course.
I was like, really?
Of course. Yeah, 20-year veteran, tour, you know, like on tour. His movie just came out a month ago. No. But they're not saying overdose. They're not going to say it. They're just saying, oh, we found a lot of drugs in his system. Uh-huh. What about the cardiovascular collapse here and the fact that the ambulance didn't even make it to him in time? He called and said, I got pain in my chest. What do you think that is? And just died. Died in his hotel room. So, yeah. Yeah. And again, that there you go.
Enlarged heart, though. His heart weighed 600 grams, double the average size.
It's a mystery, Karen. I don't know what could have caused that. It's really, really weird. And remember the mystery. You remember back when this was back in December, the Foo Fighters canceled part of their tour because a band member, which they wouldn't say who it was, had some medical condition, which they wouldn't say what it was. And he's the type of guy, I have watched interviews by him, wonderful to listen to, very enthusiastic, very, you know, he was a musician in his veins. And he was the type of guy to be like, no, I'm just going to keep freaking playing. Screw this. It's like, what is it going to help anybody? I'm just going to play. And he did. And that was it. So, yeah. Foo Fighters drummer. Gone at the age of, what was it, 50?
Yeah, 50. Yeah. That's a shame.
Yeah, it is a shame. But to the other people, you know who you are, who didn't take it. Well, you made the right choice, I think. Next one down, we only have a couple more before the break. Yeah, we can do these two before the break. Okay, first one, another gunned country music star, Jeff Carson, 58, quit country music, become a policeman. Don't know why. Had a heart attack at a hospital. There you go. Don't have to say anything more about that. It's kind of weird. A lot of people under the age of 60, they're just dying from heart attacks. Weird. I have no idea what it could be. Probably nothing to do with a virus of unknown origin. Okay, last but not least, before we go to the break, the segue right back into the Russia thing, which is if World War III ever occurs, here are the safest countries. And Brian Burton and I were going over this list before the show, and the first two make absolute sense. In fact, one of them you know very well because we've all heard the rumors the billionaires are going there. The first one is Iceland, right? Safest country. However, it's pretty cold. Not a lot going on up there. Iceland, not the best place. And second one, absolutely New Zealand. Everyone's heard about this. The rich are building all sorts of wonderful places down there in New Zealand, and I've been there personally. A wonderful place, way out of the way. If everything, you know, everything goes to hell, that's a great place. Every other country here, and we'll thumb through them really fast because we've got like 90 seconds. Okay, number three, Denmark. I don't think so. I don't think Denmark's going to work.
It just shows a picture of ice.
Right. Number four, Portugal. How does that work? That's right on the tip of Europe. Portugal, it's like, yeah, the quiet life. No, I don't think so.
Portugal? Next one. I would go to Portugal.
Well, Portugal, it's not bad, but it's not completely immune compared. You want to get away from the action. Slovenia makes no sense at all. Slovenia, the quiet ex-Yugoslavia. That's funny. Next one, Austria. No. It's like these are all in the middle of it. Switzerland, maybe Switzerland. I mean, just because they're neutral. I mean, politically, they might be safe. Geographically, Ireland. I mean, UK is going to be in the middle of it. Ireland would buy you some time, but that's about it. And then the next one, Czech Republic. Absolutely not. In fact, they even say here, NATO status makes it less safe. So why is it on the list? Why is it on the list? Okay, 30 seconds. Who's left? Canada. Again, maybe. Maybe Singapore makes no sense at all.
Czech Republic has the highest drinking rate, too. They drink a lot there.
Japan, betting on peace. No, Japan's not a Finland.
Singapore.
Norway. I mean, you see a trend here. Sweden, you know, Northern Europe, Australia. I don't know about Australia. So that's the last of them.
Australia?
Yeah.
How the hell would anybody go to Australia right now? Have everybody seen the nightmare that's going on over there? Hell to the no!
It's a terrible
hell
list.
Hell to the no.
It's absolutely. We'll come back. 3 minutes. We'll bring on Master Gunner. Talk about what's coming.
Real people, real radio.
Initiating the truth frequency.
This is Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World, part 2 of 4. It's you, me, and the always wonderful Karen B. And special guest tonight, U.S. Army Master Gunner, retired, hopefully permanently. We're not going to sure about that. Brian Burton, we are bringing him on. Brian has served in both the European, he's been in the European bases. He's served in the Middle East, the whole career, the whole U.S. Army thing. How are you there, Brian?
Yes.
Cool.
Everything is just double rainbows. Beautiful.
Yes. Yes, it is. There's nothing wrong at all. What's happening? And the reason I'm bringing Brian is I want to drive home the point of what's happening here behind the scenes, which you're not seeing. Basically, everything in the mainstream media over here in the United States is the exact opposite of what's happening over there. And they're downplaying the PetroRuble to a great deal, and I want to reiterate here, the petrodollar is something we care about more than anything else. Forget about democracy, screw your freedoms, you know, that whole thing. It's not about freedom. It is about the dollar. It is about our exchange rate versus the world. And by that, here's what I mean: when you trade in oil, if oil is dollars, and there is always a demand for oil, that means there's always a high demand for dollars. And we have kept an absolute zero tolerance policy for that, meaning we don't want anything to diminish that demand ever. And anyone that even thinks about it, we hit with something. Saudi Arabia, you probably heard of these. Iraq, Iran, got involved in the Kuwait thing. We care a lot. Brian, would you agree with those statements?
Yes.
Good.
Absolutely.
So that being said, Russia coming in and saying, oh, no, we've got a replacement for the petrodollar, an actual replacement, and we're initiating it now, that probably sent shockwaves through all of our intelligence community and shockwaves through the financial world, just at a low level, because it's not going to happen until Thursday. Also agree?
Yes.
So,
although I will say this,
what?
I shouldn't have thrown them for a shock, but yes.
Yeah. So what's going to happen here, and Brian and I are going to flesh a little bit of this out for you, is starting Thursday, despite what you see in the markets, every day the Russians are working this system, the American dollar is going to start losing value. And the United States, I'm going to try to be as clear as I can here, the United States would rather fight than let that happen. Agreed?
Yes.
Yes. So what I'm saying here is it's not and I don't want to necessarily, you know, I don't like fear porn necessarily, but I got to put this out there. We will do anything to keep that dollar propped up. And by that, I mean, if we have to go, it's not that we want to start a war with Russia. We have to start a war with Russia if that's going to happen. If this works, if Russia starts, again, it's going to be a peer pressure thing. Once the first few countries start caving in and buying oil and gas from them and paying in rubles, the United States is going to just go frantic. So I have some ideas, and I know Brian does too, of how this progresses. Care to chime in?
Okay, yeah. So I want to base this off of one quick thing. Sure. So the reason why our money is so important.
Right.
Our country is full of, quote, I'm going to Karen, I'll put it in air quotes for you, quote, freedoms and everything else that we enjoy and all that.
Yep. God bless us.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, it is still the most wonderful country. It's the best country in the world. Not saying it's a great country. It's the best country in the world, I think. But anyways,
I'm not ready once to leave it.
The economy starts to collapse and you start having unemployment problems, gas, you know, can't get to gas and all that. Start having little civil unrest problems and all that.
Yep.
The powers that be have to control. So then you start etching, kind of like, and I'm going to go and bring this in. We were talking about it before.
Yeah.
COVID was a great 2-year run to see how they could lock the people down.
Right.
Exactly.
Can you be stuck at your home? Yes, we can do it. Can you get your stuff online and shipped to you? Yes, you can do it.
Yes.
So when our dollar starts to drop, they get more power. But they don't want that to happen. They want the more power, but they don't want civil unrest.
Yeah, yeah. You want to be able to turn the screws on the general public, but you don't want to lose your overall power. Which is if too many dollars start coming back our way, because people remember there are countries that are holding our dollars out there because they're worth a lot. But once they start being worth less, they're going to dump them. And if they start coming our way, our inflation will just keep ratcheting up and ratcheting up and ratcheting up. And I'll throw out some of the rhetoric. You are in some ways the war, the money war is already in full swing. Because that's what they're doing. It's like, oh yeah, you know, sometimes financial ramifications can impact a country even more than physical ones. And and the general public just doesn't get that. It's like, okay, let me give you some perspective. Right now, your gas is inching up towards $5 a gallon, depending on where you are. If you're in California, more. Your attitude is a certain way. What happens when that hits 8? What happens when that hits 12? And so on, and apply that to everything else. It wouldn't be just gas. And this is a very real scenario, and the United States is extremely proactive when it comes to that. So, if it was me, I mean, what I'm saying here is you're probably going to see some sort of false flag. Doesn't have to be a false flag. But you're probably going to see some sort of false flag either on the edge of Ukraine, bordering into Poland, something to give even limited justification to move in the troops that we've been massing on the European theater. Yes?
Yes.
Yeah.
In a false flag, the key things, and I was talking to you this a couple of weeks ago when I first saw the first article,
right.
But I've always noticed when before we go into conflict – anywhere,
yeah.
You start seeing the media start posting the articles about the babies,
right?
The preemies, the babies in the hospital, and they start putting little photos up. And I'm starting to see more and more articles on the babies, because why? It's like showing puppy dogs and babies. That makes the public, oh, we should help them,
right?
Because he's such a butcher,
right? But they doesn't have to be – so what, and by the way, for those of you who may be new to the show and you don't know officially what a false flag is, it means that you do something and you blame it on somebody else. Going back to the ships, you literally fly – your ship is going next to another ship. You fly a friendly flag color, and then when you get really close to them, you blow the hell out of them. You can do that with just about anything. You can
– or even better – half false flag, I'll call it, where supposedly like World War One, the Lusitania got sunk.
Right.
They sunk a British passenger ship. They forget to tell you that passenger ship was carrying all the United States ammo and gunpowder, all that.
Right.
Fight the Germans. So you send a Red Cross refugee plane over to help the Ukrainians. It just happens to be full of, I don't know, Stinger missiles.
Yeah.
Shoots it down. All they tell you is they shot down American refugees.
Right.
Or Americans helping the refugees.
So what we're kind of saying here, and we'll expand on this a little bit, which is there's no way I can really sugarcoat it. We're going in. It's just a question, and we're on the clock right now. We're on the clock as of Thursday. Honestly, the Americans have been on the clock ever since Russia made the announcement they were tying the ruble to oil. It is no different, if you know your history at all, it's no different than, and correct me if I'm wrong here, Brian, of when we, just before Japan took Pearl Harbor, we shut off their oil. And mm-hmm. And you remember, that was back in the days when you couldn't get oil from just anywhere. And all of a sudden, Japan's like, as soon as we did that, Japan was on the clock. It's like, okay, how much oil do we have? Can we actually do a war with the oil that we have and then subsidize it later, just scramble and get it from wherever we can? And the answer was yes. But the point is they were on the clock. There was a very, very limited window. Same thing with the PetroRuble, which is America is now faced with a choice. Well, look, the inflation's already bad, but it would get way, way worse if all of a sudden everybody started buying Russian resources with rubles.
So, and the clock is also based on you've got to do it quick enough before enough countries start to actually do it.
Right. Yeah, you do not want peer pressure, yeah, otherwise known as the Ash experiment, to kick in here. Because once the – you know how it goes. Once the first people – because remember, there's – as much as the articles which I read, whereas Europe, you know, it's like, oh, we're going to stand with America. Well, kind of because you have to.
But I got to address that real quick. I'm sorry. What? I got to address that BS thing. All right. Just some quick little facts, okay? Last year during the, quote, great pandemic,
yeah,
Europe had 155 billion cubic meters of fuel from Russia.
Natural gas. Yeah.
Natural gas. We're going to supply them, they announced, with 15.
Yeah.
Where are they getting the other 145 to run their crap?
Exactly. Yeah.
So
means there's going to be some people buying under the table, and we're going to know. We're not going to report on it, or we're going to try to tell them not, but Russia's going to leak it. It's like, yeah, you know what? They're buying it from us anyway.
Well, they have to, otherwise their country will fall.
Yeah. Yeah, Germany especially.
Is where the majority of our bases are.
Exactly. And we should probably pull up – Karen, can we pull this up really quick? The map. And it's like, okay, first let's get the fear – let's neutralize it a little bit. Are you saying that Los Angeles and New York are going to get torched tomorrow? No, I'm not. Mostly because our military has stretched, it's kind of like Rome. We've stretched a long way, and the map that should be up on screen here, just the European theater. We have, I'm not even going to count them. We've got a huge amount of army bases. We've got navy bases. Well, let's see. We've got army bases in Belgium, Germany, and Italy, and Netherlands. We've got navy bases in Greece, Italy, and Spain. We've got air force bases in the UK, Germany, Portugal, Turkey, and Italy. And then other, I'm not even going to go into that. So, anything that's going to happen, it's going to happen over there. And it's just going to happen to us over there. That's where it'll start.
Now, remember something, too.
Yeah.
Those military bases,
yeah,
they're family orientated. I mean, it's not just soldiers there. You bring your family over there.
Right.
Yeah. I was going to say, my cousin used to live on a base in Germany, and she's not in the military. Her husband is. Yeah.
My oldest son, his first school was over in Germany.
Yeah.
So, I mean, so if anything happens over there, they're not going to show the soldiers, but they're going to show the family housing wiped out.
Right. So, let's go back to the false flag thing. We can't wait for Russia to make a mistake.
No.
So we're going to make it for them.
I won't say we'll make it for them. I will say we will force their hand.
Right.
You know, it's kind of like what was a couple weeks ago when they're talking about Poland's going to send planes into the Ukraine to help them, to support them, which was BS because the first question is, well, how do you get the planes there?
Right.
Do you bring the Ukrainian pilots out of the Ukraine to pick the planes up and fly them in there? Or does our, quote, NATO pilots fly them in there? And the second they cross the border, you force Russia. Once one's shot down, that's it. You're in a shooting war.
Right.
So it's this is a real easy scenario to push.
Yes. Well, heck, let's bring up the the training thing. So last week, amazing what a week can do. We were talking about the training facilities in Ukraine. They were just getting slammed by cruise missiles. So what you guys don't know is we're sending quote unquote advisors over there. They call them mercenaries, but we're sending advisors.
We call them Green Beret.
Green Berets, yes. And we were training Ukrainians. Americans and British soldiers are training Ukrainians on our missile, our weapon systems, because, well, it's one thing we do very, very well is we make weapon systems. And Russia was figuring out where those places were, and it was like, oh, okay, bomb, 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 bomb. We're just going to blow those all up. So the next headline down, which was I think U.S. troops in Poland are training Ukrainians on how to use weapons. So this is from MSN, and this is what Biden said. This is a CNN article. Biden comes on and says, oh, yeah, we're training troops in Ukrainians in Poland. The United States is, which is interesting. It's like, why would you be training in Poland? Because you can't train them in Ukraine because we're tired of getting blown up. So immediately right after that, so that was 10 hours ago, the top commander in Europe – right afterwards, and this is from The Hill, top commander in Europe, U.S. not currently training Ukrainian forces in Poland. And I love this line that he uses. This is from the he says, I do not believe that we are in the process of currently training military forces from Ukraine in Poland, said General Todd Walters, who is also NATO's supreme allied commander in Europe. So you are, you aren't. I don't believe that you are. Because you don't know,
right?
So you I'm going to say this.
Yes.
Unlike our president, majority of the words that come out of the military command,
yeah,
out of military, is very much checked, double checked, and reassured.
Right.
So when they say, he didn't say we're not doing it. When he says, I believe we're not doing it.
Yeah.
It's a good play because you always come back, oh, I didn't realize.
Yeah. Which is, by the way, one degree of separation from our guys being there. So, no, we're not – our troops aren't in there. We're just on the other side of the border hooking up the weapon systems and then shipping the Ukrainians back in. We're right. Basically – we're on a technicality war right now.
They could be not in Poland. They could be in another country teach them, for example.
Right. Right.
It's a very, you got the words are very specific on the news media. They're very specific for a reason.
Right.
Unless you're the president, then you just screw everything up.
Right. And let's do the last two headlines. Just get them out of the way. Then we'll talk a little bit more on the other stuff. And then we'll take phone calls, which is the saber rattling is getting all over the place. So MSN, the next headline down was from CNBC. We will come and we will find you. U.S. issues warning to anyone helping Russia bypass sanctions. We want to make clear to crypto exchanges, to financial institutions, to individuals, to anyone who may be in the position to help Russia take advantage and evade our sanctions. We will hold you accountable. Uh-huh. And it basically, his comments come shortly after G7 major economies pledged to ensure the Russian state elites, proxies, and oligarchs would not be able to leverage digital assets to sidestep the impact. Look, there's money to be made here. Wars, there's a wonderful movie out there called Why We Fight, and the profit margin on wars right now is, I think, sitting at almost 30%. And if you know anything about that, if you're getting a return rate of 30%, you're going to see a lot more of whatever that is. And there's money.
No, war is profitable.
War is extremely profitable. Very, very profitable. And speaking of that, let's just end the articles with this. This is the sanctions. This is from RT. Again, highly recommend people go to RT.com as long as that site is up, which is Russians say it's a very pretty picture. It is impossible to sanction Russian gold. Sanctions are an ineffective, impractical instrument, as they always have unintended consequences that negatively impact the countries that impose them. There was something else they said where the latest ban, he said, it's impossible to sanction the Russian central bank's gold. Firstly, because the Russian central bank is a buyer of gold, not a seller. Secondly, the refining process to produce gold bars and coins is easily replicated. Russian gold can easily be melted, taken to another refiner, assayed, and molded into bars and resold.
Yeah, so gold is gold.
Gold is gold. And which is why it was genius. The other part that people, again, were missing, it's not just that they created the PetroRuble. They linked ruble to gold. Which means You don't even have to use – here's the other thing. Sorry if everyone missed this, which is you don't even have to use rubles to buy the oil and gas. You can just use gold.
We'll accept gold.
Yeah, we'll accept gold.
And if they pay them all in gold, then Russia starts stocking up on gold.
Yep.
Russia's got money. Unless we go in and take that gold, they've got gold. They've got money. They can continue buying from, I don't know, their partners, China. Yes. Iran is a partner with Russia. See, that's the funny thing. Iran supports Russia, and we're going to buy oil from Iran.
Right. Oh, yeah, yeah. The Iranian thing, we also can't downplay, which is like, look, if you're old enough to remember, you're listening to this, look, Iran was the bad guys, always have been the bad guys. And then all of a sudden it's like, yeah, yeah. So can we have some of your oil and stuff? Because we need it. Remember, we already told the rest of the Middle East, especially, you know, our good friends Israel, we told them, it's like, oh, no, we got Iran. We got to totally handle. We'll give them the hammer.
And here's the funny part about that. So we're going to get from Iran. But wait, what about Saudi Arabia?
Oh, yeah.
Which are, quote, our allies, but whatever the fuck.
Yeah, even though.
What about that wonderful place I spent half my career in called Iraq?
Oh, yeah, Iraq. That was a thing, right? That happened.
I'm pretty sure it happened. I spent half my fucking career there. But yeah. Yeah, how come we're not pulling oil out of Iraq and, you know, Saudi Arabia and, I don't know, the good places like, I don't know, Texas, Alaska, whatever. Oh, yeah.
As the listener may know, Brian is a big believer of improving petroleum, tapping every reserve. We're going to do it anyway. If it gets to the point, you won't have to worry about that because
to that. We should be pumping our own oil. Why wouldn't we be?
Blue team.
Yeah, that's so retarded. But, you know, this is all by design. All these assholes up at the top, all of this stuff, they're just – this is all by design. Everybody has realized this, right?
Do you want to get in? Do you want to get into this?
I mean, they always fund both sides of the war. They've been doing this for decades.
I'm gonna agree with you on this, Karen, because me and Mark talked about this. I'm going to give you the analogy of what they're doing.
Okay.
So occasionally, you know, you got all your pets – and occasionally, you know what? I want to see which one's stronger. I'm going to start batting them against each other.
Yep.
Let's see who comes out on top, which looks to me, if you ask me.
At the highest level, Karen, you are absolutely right.
Yes.
Oh, wait. Did I forget to say, that was Joe Jackson stepping out? Damn it. I'm so sorry. Joe Jackson stepping out from his album. From his album, Karen.
Night and day.
Yeah, sorry about that. I almost missed the entire segment. I am so sorry. But now somebody at home is going, oh, thank God he said it. But no, you're absolutely right, Karen, in that at the highest level, what we're talking right now is the media level, what you're going to see and what you're about. But you're right. At the highest level, they have basically figured out a way finally, and it's all part of the plan, to get the biggest kids on the block to finally have the showdown. This is it.
Karen, I think the whole COVID thing was a training, a test to see how much they could lock us down. And I mean,
of course,
it's successful after 2 weeks. I mean, 2 years. I mean, whatever the hell it was. So now let's go to the next step.
Yeah. So now it's going to be the remake of West Side Story, which you never wanted, which is the two biggest kids, one on this side, one on this side, big sticks on the ground. And then, of course, you've got – I don't even know how much we can go into that. Somebody asked about China, which is basically Doctor Strange's sidekick who's sitting on the side. I'm not being racist when I say that. Who's sitting on the side is like, okay, he's the wild card over there. Don't know what's going to happen with that. We'll just back up real quick. We got time, don't we? We got a couple minutes. Yeah. Which is – don't forget. So again, don't – it's not just what the media tells you. It's what they're not telling you. So it's like, oh, Europe's standing strong against Russia and the atrocities. But there's other countries, really big countries, that are kind of standing back going, yeah, we're just going to go wait and see what's going to happen there. One is China, which is a huge, huge deal. China's not condemning anyone. And Russia's like, yeah, you know, we share a big border with you. We'll sell you anything you want. And then the other one's India. And you're going, so what about – it's like India has 1 billion people. That kind of snuck up on people. And it's like, and they have a huge, by the way, they have a huge influence over here, especially in the tech sector, especially in the medical sector. There's a lot of Indians over here. Well, in fact, there's probably more Indians than there are Chinese. So there's a lot of complexities here that'll kind of play out. But the first thing is, before we go to break, just want to reiterate, Russia has now forced, if you play chess at all, they have forced our hand. They have fortified themselves, and the only thing we can do is come at them. And we can't convince people to, you know, we say, oh, we're going to go against Russia because of the PetroRuble. It's not even going to make sense to people. We're going to have to give them a simple narrative, whether it be, oh, it's the kids, it's the orphans, oh, something blew up, it's some soldier thing, it's a chemical attack, it's a tactical thing, whatever it is. But we're going to make up something, a simple narrative to go in, because the general public doesn't know anything about economics at all. And that's what it's about. It's about the dollar. Does that make sense, Brian?
Yes. Although I am still rooting for the Lex Luthor plan still.
The Lex Luthor plan, by the way, is to drop a nuke on the San Andreas Fault in California, therefore splitting the state, sinking Los Angeles and into the sea. And then it starts from there. And honestly, I'm sure they've watched the movie as well. And I'm sure it's in their heads. I'm sure they've got seismologists. It's like, would that work? It's like, it's a crapshoot. You'd be better off hitting Yosemite. Go after the super volcano or the.
There is no super volcano.
How about the?
I don't believe that.
All right. Well, how about the fault lines in near Memphis?
There's no nukes either.
Well, there's something. Well.
There's
agree to disagree.
There's explosives, but
whatever their advanced weaponry. I'm saying advanced.
Because the nukes just. You can't split a Taurus field.
All right. Anyway, we come back. We're going to take your calls. We'll leave Brian on the line in case you got military questions. His face is in the muck. I think his zipper's stuck.
Hi. My name is Ella.
Wherever you are, make it Truth Frequency Radio.
Welcome back to Strange World, Part 3 of 4. It's you, me, Karen B, and U.S. Army Master Gunner Brian Burton. Okay, so what was I going to do? Oh, yeah, phone calls. 213-233-3998. That's 213-233-3998. And before we pick up the first call, we should bring up Brian and I were talking about some American targets. He and I were debating. It's like, okay, if you had to hit one city with whatever it was, who would you hit? And it's like to if you only could pick one city in America to make the most impact and send a message, what would it be? And we were humming back and forth. I said Eastern Seaboard, you know, obvious choices without the capital. Washington, D.C. doesn't count. And you chose Los Angeles.
Yes, absolutely.
Los Angeles.
Perfect.
I know. Yes. That surprised me, too.
Here's why.
Okay.
If you don't want to have, if you want to have minimal disruption to financial economy,
right?
Because you can't hit New York, you throw the finances off,
right?
But you want to get the most people, but you want to also cause the biggest impact for the people to go, oh, they hurt us, we need to go kill them.
The psychologicals, yeah.
LA's perfect because the only main function out of LA is Hollywood.
Right.
So without being too cold, you're basically saying that most people in LA are expendable.
I'm not saying they're expendable. They're the perfect target.
Yeah.
Because
everybody else, you're trying to retain.
My gosh, you take out the Kardashians.
you take out all kinds of famous people if you hit. Oh, Stefan lives there.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, I thought Stefan lived. No. Oh, I thought he was in the Bay Area.
No, no, no. He lives down there by Los Angeles.
Hopefully he's not listening.
The impact and the crying of the people taking out the Kardashians.
Oh, yeah, Britney. Yeah. You hit psychologically the entertainment
industry. You also get millions of people. We're going to war, and the whole country will back it and buy war bonds.
Yep. Good point. But the surviving celebrities, wherever they may be, New York or wherever. Yeah. All right. I'll go with L.A. Sure. It kind of reminds me of War Games. Remember that the kid with Matthew Broderick and Ali Sheedy when they were trying to pick a target, and they're like, get Seattle. Yeah, Seattle. they wiped out Seattle and Alaska, I think, or Seattle and Vegas. Vegas. Yeah, that's right. It was Vegas and Seattle, which were weird choices. Okay, let's pick up, since we're making fun of World War III, let's, because we got to keep it light, because if you're not laughing, you're crying. Let's pick up some phone calls. Let's do 518 line unmuted. You are on Strange World. What is your question? And don't forget, it can be for me or Karen or Master Gunner. Hello, New York.
Hello.
All right. He might be just listening. We'll give the benefit of the doubt. We're going to switch over to 937 out of Ohio. Line unmuted. Same thing. Same verse. Second verse, same as the first. Phone lines are working, right, Brian?
They look like they're working.
All right. Ohio. All right. You know what? I'm just going to go down the list. All right.
This is really weird.
That is weird. I know. Watch us get blocked.
Cyber hack.
Yeah, because we're talking about it. It's not the Russians, by the way. Well, it's obviously the Iranian-backed rebels that are doing this. Remember what I said, the translation to that. 530 out of California. Can you hear me? We have a problem.
We do.
We do. This is odd. I'm just going to keep going down the list. Yeah, all right, I'm going to put
wrong
you
with the phone lines. Something, obviously,
something wrong with the phone lines.
Obviously.
Phone. I'm going to have Peanut Gallery reset it. So while he's resetting it, let's go over the meetups again real fast. There's going to be go to flatearthfestivals.com. For the latest meetups, there's one in Massachusetts.
That's right. Oh, by the way, since we have a little moment here, I can let everybody know that Flattoberfest 2022 has been finalized. The date is set and the venue has been booked, and it's going to be happening October 22nd and 23rd, 2022. It's a whole weekend. We'll have a meetup on Friday. We'll rent the park across the street because we've been at the Greenville Shrine Club before. So we're going to be back there again. This will be my third event at this venue. They had a cancellation come up, and they called me and said, we would love to have you back.
Oh, that's nice.
Isn't that great? They love us there. So, we're going to be there again, and it was a great venue. We had a blast at the other times that we had events there, so we're going to do it again, and this time we have it for 2 days. Last time I only had it for one, okay. So this time 2 days, and it'll be a whole weekend. And it'll be so much fun, and hopefully Mark will be there.
I am going to do my best, honestly. I am.
You know, I got to say something on this topic, too, by the way.
What, the conference?
No. No, no. Everything we're talking about.
Oh, okay. World War III.
Real quick. Yeah. So, regardless of what you believe of New World Order, Illuminati, or whatever, whoever's in power, wars are fake and everything else.
Yeah.
How they're set up could probably lie. Yes, I'll agree. But no matter what they're doing, the effects down on the lower people of us, there will be conflict. There will be, you know what I'm saying? Whether it's bullshit or not.
Well, it's bullshit. The reasoning behind it is bullshit.
The reasoning behind it's bullshit, yes.
Yeah.
But people have to realize this will probably still happen.
Yeah, they make things suck for us on purpose.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Very true.
That's the point. Yeah.
All right, let's try the phone lines again. We're going to go I'm going to start from the top. Let's go 518. 518 New York. Line unmuted. Can you hear me? I got nothing. All right. You know what? I'm going to just pick lines on random. Let's do how about 269 Michigan? Say something. I'm talking to you.
Marcus the Reverend.
Oh,
yes. Hey.
Sweet. All right, finally. So the phone lines aren't broken.
Hey.
All right. Yeah. So
thank
what,
you. I'm
what,
glad, I, glad to save the day.
Yes, you did. What's happening, man?
Oh, nothing much. Hello to Karen, Master Gunner, yourself, Mark. I'm excited to be here. How about you guys?
All things considered, I can't really complain.
Yeah. Heck, we're still alive. Cheers to that, right? Have a beer, right? On me.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, Master Gunner, I remember you from way back when.
Way back when.
Hello?
How far?
Some
of the early shows?
You know. Yeah. 4 years ago or something. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. You took it upon yourself to explain to the community that you've had experience with long-range shooting with those guns.
Right.
And to you, it didn't make no curve, man.
Nope. Not calculated.
Nope. Not calculated.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right on. Yep. So what's on your mind? Hey. Anything special, or are you just calling in to say hi?
So I have a fun little bit of news for you.
Okay.
The other day, I was hanging out on Twitter, and I noticed Elon posted something regarding space-related thing, naturally. And it just so happened that I was able to pull out the pressure systems argument. And so I said, you know, hey, you know, I got this fact here of, you know, pressure systems need a container. So, and I know that nobody's busted through a container. So I said, you know, what's going on there, Elon Musk? And he hasn't replied yet, but he hasn't blocked me either. So that's good. We'll take it.
Yeah, you know what? If you're not blocked, that's still something. Sure.
It is something. I have celebrities that have blocked me for no reason, man. I'm talking nice to them. I wasn't being a jerk. And next thing I know, I can't message them. I'm like, okay. Whatever. So.
All right.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool stuff.
Yeah, it was pretty exciting. I was happy. I didn't realize until after I was done. I was like, oh no, I just red pilled the poor guy. But yeah, I'm gonna. Don't worry. I'm not. I'm not leaving our buddy Elon alone. Don't worry.
No. He. You gotta remember, he doesn't believe in. I mean, Joe Rogan. He talked to Joe Rogan. Tried to talk to him about the whole community, the full flat Earth thing, a while back, and he didn't even think it was a thing. He didn't even think it was a community at all. And Joe, I will say this: he had to set him straight. He's like, no, man, don't underestimate these guys. You know, they're real. They're organized. They're articulate. And, you know, he was basically saying, do not just blow, you know, wave these guys off as just some nothing group, because we are very serious.
It's 11-11.
Oh, yeah.
11-11. Nice. Oh, a little ASMR there.
Oh, nice.
So,
I'm not sure
any
military time. It's 23-11 right, in military.
Well, depending on where you are, yes. Anything else before any shout?
Right.
Any shout outs before I send you off?
I don't know. Let's just go out. I know. I got a great one. I got a shout out to one of my personal health things. Okay. This is not health advice. This is me. Okay. I've always liked the classic red Campbell's just chicken noodle soup.
Hell yeah.
Shout out to a can of soup. You know what? I've been doing this
shout
for 7 years. Gold star for originality. All right. Hey man, you have a good night, and we will talk to you soon. All right, let's see. I'm gonna go back up to the top of the list, see if we can get there. New York 518. Are you there? Or are you just listening? I'm just gonna go down the list. New York's just listening. Ohio, are you there? Or are you just listening? Got nothing. I'm going to go from the bottom. Something going on here. Pennsylvania, 484. Oh, 484. He's never going to pick up, is he? 484, you there?
No.
No. 530 out of California. I can hear you.
Excellent. How's it going, guys? It is William.
Hey, what's happening, man?
Hi, William.
Hey. Hey, Karen. How's it going?
Good.
Hey, so Master Gunner, good evening.
Hey.
Excellent. Good you probably evening. Don't remember, but I am ex-military myself. So, anyway, it sounds like you guys are talking about World War III.
Yeah. Yeah, it should start. Well, what time is it now? Pretty soon. It's yeah, yeah. We're kind of getting ready for it. We're being proactive on this one. Other people are talking about other silly frivolous things. We're saying that the kids on the block are squaring off. They haven't started swinging yet, but they're squaring off.
So you really are in a bunker.
No. I don't know. Look, I'm not in New Zealand or Iceland, and everybody else on that list, I don't really go in, you know, maybe in the northern part of Canada. But we don't know what's going to happen. I mean, it's going to be very fluid, whatever happens. I'm just saying that this isn't going to be another Afghanistan or something like this. This is like what
and
Karen is saying.
It's not going to be end of Terminator or something like that.
No, it's not going to be the Terminator series. It's not going to be a James Cameron movie. It's going to be something. It's going to be something different.
We do remember 2 years ago when Trump, the Monday after St. Patrick's Day after COVID hit America, he did sign in, if I'm not mistaken, the National Production Act that he said would cause the UN beautiful. He said it was a beautiful resolution. Is beautiful. It'll let the UN respond to any plan, and he said planned events, and that was kind of weird. So
yeah,
I like the LA thing, City of Angels. Why not? There's a lot of people down there, and
sure,
yeah, I don't know. So
well, we'll see. Again, I'm just trying to get people in the right frame of mind. I believe with agree with Karen, and at the highest level, which is what we're thinking, which is at the highest level, you know, the Great Reset is no lie. I've listened to people on this island. The term is actually flying around there pretty quick now, where the average person on the street at least understands at the veneer of it, what the Great Reset means. But yeah, there's people in high levels of authority. They want the big punch out, the big act three, the big.
Got to have a catastrophe in order to make people want to reset. If you think about, we got most of our social things after, quote, the Depression and the Dust Bowl and all that.
Right.
So you have to cause people pain and agony so they can go help us, and then you can reset their standards.
Right, right. You create such a mess that the people demand. It's like, we need to have it cleaned up. We don't care how you clean it up. Just freaking fix it. And then there's books on this where it's like, okay. And then you lay out this plan. It's like, I don't care. As long as it gets fixed, I don't care what I have to give up. And there you have it.
Yeah. Well, I believe a lot of people are straight up missing. And just take the workforce, for instance. Where did they all go? Because not that many people died from COVID, right? So we know that. So the county offices, which is I had been having to deal with recently in the last year, being a parent again, and they're at 30%, and they pay really well. So everybody across the board is working with 30 to 50%, yet there's people in my town I've never seen. So there's brand new people here, but we're still not employing people. So they're underground. I honestly believe the elite are underground. And they're ready. And they're ready to
do
above ground.
I think they're prepped, but they don't have to get underground yet. We're not We're not quite there yet. Again, do not forget that the narrative, something I've talked about for a long time, which is the narrative for the general public is really, really dumb. Not the enlightened, wonderful, articulate people that are listening right now. I'm talking the general public. They are mouth-breathing troglodytes that know nothing about chemistry or biochemistry or engineering or even economics. So the narrative has to be very, very easy. And so you will see it coming a mile away because the media, you've seen the stories. Russia is bad. Ukraine is good. Orange man bad, right? You know, Biden good. It's just really, really simple narratives. So when you start seeing, you know, in 200 point font, you know, like war coming soon, you know, just translate it down to caveman speak, then maybe get into the bunkers. But until then, no, it's not the movie 2012 where all of a sudden people get a text on their phone and they head to the freaking Alps, so, or the Himalayas, sorry.
And you know, well, here's the thing. What I'm saying is that there's nowhere to go to for the general public anyway at this point.
Right.
So if you didn't build your own bunker, well, then, you know, you're SOL. So I'm saying that important people already are taking cover. Why would they tell us?
Well, again, we'll see. And a lot of things can happen, and it might be a limited conflict. You know, nobody wants necessarily the infrastructure. You don't want a scorched earth policy necessarily.
I mean, if you think World War I and World War II never really touched the United States.
No, we were very fortunate, especially for World War. I mean, again, one of the big reasons the United States did so well after World War II is we suffered almost no civilian casualties whatsoever.
We were the only ones left in the world that could make shit.
Yeah, we were. Everybody else was on fire. I mean, Russia was a freaking disaster. England was burning. All of Europe was gone. China was damaged way more than people let on. Japan, when you saw what happened there. We were the only people making stuff. So, yeah, we'll see. I'm cautiously optimistic, but I just know it has to happen now. The chess moves have been made. You know, in chess, you know, you force people into a certain thing. It's like they have no choice but to make this move. We have to do it now because they are men in power. Do not like giving up power voluntarily. We are not going to voluntarily let the dollar slide into no
man. They're going to sacrifice their pawns to save the king.
Very good. Yeah. Anyway, any shout outs?
Well, I guess, let's see, if Jake's listening, a little bit south of me, then there's also, what's his name? It's been a while. Jared, shout out to him. Zulu, one of my fellow EMT. And if she's out there listening, your old host, your old,
Patricia?
The beautiful redhead.
The red. Patricia was never on Strange World. She did her own thing called Flat Earth and Other Hot Potatoes. The only woman, and it's always been you, Karen. The only woman in my life on this show is Karen B. Just so you know. Anyway, I gotta let you go because I want to pick up one more call before the break. But thank you for calling in.
All right. Peace out.
All right, see you, man. Where am I going? Let's try. This is an odd one. 360, are you on the line right now? Line unmuted.
Hello?
Hey.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, hi. It's Valley Music Journey on the backup phone because I thought you wouldn't answer my other one after yet last week, and I said you guys jumped the shark as flat earthers.
No, why? No, you're not blacklisted, man. You're fine. What's going on? No, because you're having some phone line issues. So anyway, what do you got? I'll take you to the break. What do you got?
I was kidding. But the top 10 would be great. I would start with Piers Morgan interview because I believe you're the only flat earther that's debated an astronaut live on TV, especially on the big network like that.
That is true. And I was sad that I could not put it on my channel because of copyright issues. And I know, again, I accept the criticism. People are like, you got to go for the jugular. You should have made fun of the astronaut and accused him of being a liar and all that stuff. And it's like, look, I wasn't, you know, I've got the producers in my ear and I wanted to go the full, whatever it was, 8-9 minutes. And I mean, yeah, I could have gone 60 seconds and gone all Alex Stein and get cut off at like the 2 minute mark. But no, I won't. So that's why I was as kind as I could. But don't forget also who's sitting right next to him, which was Piers Morgan, is the only guy that ever intimidated me, because I have seen him on so many things. Just, I mean, he's, you know, tearing into politicians, and I'm going, oh sweet God,
yeah.
he's gonna yell at me and make all sorts of snide remarks, and he didn't. He was a perfect gentleman. So
apparently the Queen eventually relieved him of his duties. He finally lost his status when the Queen came along and said, he's done, gong.
I just saw him over here yesterday on Fox News, believe it or not.
Yeah, he's over here now. He left his show over there.
Yeah, he gets kicked out of whatever country he's in pretty regularly. We kicked him out a few years ago, and he's kicked back over here. So, yeah.
I do have a geopolitical question, being from NES Whidbey area here, and I hope everybody's safe. But so, getting to the question of if there are really nukes, or if there really is a full scale deal.
Yeah.
You guys had a last caller talk about the bunkers. Well, you were at the Dallas conference, and so Brian, I just wanted to mention to you that people at the Dallas conference were very credible, told me about the dumbs there, and that they'd been down in them for a long time as contractors for the military. So how many years can they hang out down there while the rest of us fry up above so they can pull off this geopolitical years. Thing?
Long time.
Years.
Military, oh, man.
Yeah, military doesn't do anything small. Dude, I wouldn't look, I'm not going to sweat it. Unfortunately, you live in the same area I do, and I'm not exactly bulletproof. Yeah, I'm on an island, but I have the Naval Air Station to the north. We've got some Kitsap to the south. I've got the naval thing to the east. I'm in a big triangle. So, yeah.
I'm going to make this prediction. I'll say this. I do not, whether you believe them or not, Karen, I got you. I do not think there will be a full-blown nuclear war.
You think it'll go conventional Europe for a while?
Long time, yeah. They don't need to do nuke. They don't need to do it.
That's true.
No.
The nuke, and that would go along with if they're really trying to pull the strings.
Yeah.
NATO, the whole process of nukes in the 80s was to make the Soviet Union bad, and they could hit us at any second.
Oh, they, it's don't good need way that to increase anymore. Spending, yeah. That's for sure.
Yeah. They don't need it. We have other ways to increase spending with the babies and the children and the oil, the fuel. Europe's starving. They're freezing to death in the winter.
Hey, I'm old enough to remember, Brian, Bretton Woods and the gold deal and Nixon bowing down to Saudi Arabia and running over to China, doing all those dirty deals to keep the dollar on the petrodollar. But to get to the point is, don't forget, my dad used to serve me food, and he had to lie during the rationing, and he said, oh, here's a roast beef. He'd bite into it. It was a horse ready for the glue market. I mean, it got kind of bad in the mid-73, 74.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Were you up here in 73, 74?
I was served horse meat on the table by NES Whidbey. Yes. Wow. True story.
Wow.
So hey, you're right about the petrodollar. So I know you guys got to run, but yeah, you're on point. Thank you.
Oh yeah. Yeah. No worries at all. We'll continue working on this as the story develops. Anyway, we're going to go to the break. Thank you. Thank you, Dan, for calling. We will be back in 3 minutes. Phone number to call in is 213-233-3998. I think we've got the phone lines pretty much fixed.
I'm having buffering problems on my stream. I don't know why.
Well, so probably, weird. Probably getting pinged by, you know, the Iranian back.
Why don't you talk to those guys next to you, Mark, and tell them to stop it.
No hate, no hype, no fear.
You're listening to Truth Frequency Radio.
We are TFR.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Strange World Part 4. It's you, me, and the lovely Karen B. And Master Gunner Brian Burton from the United States Army, retired. Oh, hey, Brian, we should probably bring up two things here. First, if this thing starts escalating, when this thing starts escalating, there is a chance, because you haven't been out that long, you could be recalled.
It is possible.
To head out to what?
Before they do drafts and all that, they'll go back through their roles and they'll recall retired experts that can be used for training purposes.
Right. So you would be sent down to what, Georgia?
Yeah, probably Georgia. If that happened, they'd send me to Georgia to train tankers.
Fort Benning. Wow. Benning. Hard to believe that you're probably... I am sorry in advance if you can't recall to train. I mean, you wouldn't see action probably.
Way in hell. I'm too broke
to see action.
Like I said. Oh yeah, yeah. I'm.
Oh. When you say broke, you mean you've got enough physical liabilities to be like, God, no.
No, yeah. I can't even run anymore. I got screwed up. Come on, I got blown up 12, 14 times, but still.
Not a lot of people can say they got blown up more than a dozen times and still walking around. And you still have all your fingers and toes, as far as I know.
I still got them all. Yep.
Right on. Good for you.
Yeah.
The other thing, which I know you mentioned, which was in our side thing, was that, Biden, why they keep allowing him to be put in front of the camera, I don't know. But he keeps slipping up and saying that, the first one was, and you caught that, where he was talking to the 82nd Airborne. Was it 82nd Airborne?
Yeah.
And he was saying, oh, yeah, when you guys are there. And he's talking to him while he's in Poland. It's like, why would the 82nd Airborne be in Ukraine?
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, it's probably not something you should slip up on television. And the other thing, though, he mentioned was, there's going to be some U.S. food shortages. And I know the internet and some of our circles really freaked out about that. I want to clarify, and Brian agrees with me here, that food shortages are not famines.
No.
That just means that the supermarkets, we've already seen this with some stuff, they're going to be out of certain things and possibly quite a few things. It's not that there won't be food there. It's probably just not food that you would, whatever your favorites are, you're probably not going to get all your favorites.
Plus, it's a great way to tear down some of the smaller companies to get the bigger corporations in power.
Yeah, because we need more of that.
Yes, we do. But,
yeah.
I mean, what was it?
America has a lot of redundancies when it comes to food distribution. And we've got, we have a lot of food rolling. Yes, the supermarkets. Could it possibly look like 1988 or 1980 Soviet Union, where you're just kind of picking little strays? Even they weren't necessarily starving to death. But are you going to get all your favorite cookies? Probably not.
No, and what it'll do is, the smaller restaurants and all that won't be able to get their supply of food because it's reserved for Walmart and Target and whatever else it is. So then you start – and again, that's the whole part of that COVID test is, can we get the people to shut their businesses down and can they survive?
Yeah, and they already proved. They already proved they can.
Yeah, so you can survive.
Yeah.
Might not be comfortable, but you can survive.
And what I love is, again, this will probably change for better or for worse, which was we didn't even lose. We gained 30 pounds in a year, the average American, throughout that. So it's not like we're starving. We were sitting home and double fisting Malamars and wearing out the Netflix remote. So,
which can cause heart attacks.
Yes.
Watching
everything. Yeah. Oh, there was a story I was going to run, and you guys can look it up if you want, where somebody came up with this app that analyzes your voice, just your voice. It has you read a paragraph, three paragraphs, and it can analyze, and it'll give you your heart attack rating chance based on your voice, your voice print. I'm going, huh? How's that work? But we'll see. We'll see if that catches on. I am skeptical.
Same way a PosiTrack works.
Really? You can start
it just
up.
Does.
Wow. All right. Let's see. Let's pick up. Let's try Denver, Colorado. 720, can you hear me? Say something.
I can hear you just fine. How are you, Mark?
Hey, look at that. Denver, he made it. Okay, what's going on, man?
Well, I was listening, and I think you and Gunner's analysis is very sharp. And I just wonder, for anybody on the panel, isn't the subtext of all of the military and the economic stuff, isn't the subtext what you started to touch on with one caller, the Great Reset and Agenda 2030?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. At the highest levels, that's what we're talking about here, where it appears that I'm trying to be careful not to trip the censors here, that all the 10 billion doses, you know what I'm talking about, the 10 billion doses were an insurance policy. So that you know, there's something I've always heard about people at high levels of power, and that they leave nothing to chance. And so the 10 billion doses was a great start, but they're still going to need to set some things on fire.
Oh, I just thought of something.
What?
So if we start having food shortages and all that,
yeah.
What if, sadly, a big part of the population that might have done something started dropping off to help ease food shortages?
Ooh, yeah. And you know what makes that worse is because of the injections that they got that I can't name, we can't eat them.
Oh, right. No.
We can't even eat them.
No, sorry,
well, you'll get it.
But yeah, the Soylent Green does not work, does not apply to this. So,
oh, no.
Yeah, so unjabbed people.
PetroRuble takes...
Go ahead.
Sorry, go ahead.
You're good.
Well, the PetroRuble takes down the U.S. economy. The U.S. economy stumbles and falters. We have war all summer. September comes the digital credit system, the social credit system, digital currency, and we are rolling right on towards... And it probably won't go that fast because it's only 2022, but this all seems to be precursors for everything everyone in your circles have been talking about for 15 years.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, it was interesting because nothing really clicked into place until when I was staring at the announcement of the PetroRuble. And again, you know, that's not even an official name yet. I saw it immediately for what it was, because I was like, wait a minute, that can't happen, because if they do this, that means it's the untouchable thing which Americans don't understand, which is the reason we have the high standard of living in our country is because of that. It's because we ran a protection racket on the oil industry. And it's as simple as that. Go ahead, Brian.
If they do it, if the Russia does it, then the other countries start going, hey, we could do it.
Right.
And sell our stuff. And you could see a drop of worldwide of using the dollar, which will take our power away. Because we don't make much.
There was a weird stat out there that something like 80% of the U.S. dollars are sitting in these massive bricks of $100 bills, these pallets that are all over the world. Because the U.S. dollar is so sought after. And it is. I mean, Brian's seen it too. You go to other countries, you go to a third world country, you start flashing the dollars. That's all they care about. It's like, yeah. Which is why Americans are notorious. They are the number one group. When we go out there to other countries, tourism dollars, we spend it and they want it. Because the dollars are so sought after in terms of exchange rates. So anyway,
so Thursday it might become game on Thursday.
Well, it'll start on Thursday, but it doesn't. We'll see. We'll
see.
I know
it's not going to go quick because that would make Mark too happy.
I know we don't want to do that. The
shout out to everybody listening.
Okay, and but just shout one more thing before I let you go, which is the clock. Clock starts on Thursday because we'll see if it works. If it works. Then, yeah, America's – we've already got things in place to let this happen. But, yeah, the clock starts Thursday.
Right on. Thanks for taking my call. You guys have a great show. Shout out to all you guys and everybody who doesn't call in but faithfully listens.
All right.
Oh, and Zulu 1 and Steven. Bye.
All right, bye. Zulu 1. Who's that? All right, let's go to 214 out in Dallas, Texas.
What is happening out in Dallas?
Oh, hello. We're kind of windy down here. Hello, Mark and Karen and Brian and Pina. I'm not surprised, but did I hear Dan say there were domes down here?
Deep underground military bases, otherwise known as dumb for mm-hmm. short.
Mm-hmm. Oh, one yes. dumb. Okay.
I mean, there's underground military bases in all sorts of places, some public, some private. Mm-hmm. You know, like there's probably one in the most famous ones are in New Mexico, Groom Lake, and then other
Cheyenne
places,
Mountain.
Cheyenne Mountain, of course. You know, but there's others ones we probably have no idea where they are.
Well, what is it? Maryland's got a big one. That's where I forgot the name. Where the president goes all the damn time. That's a full underground base over there.
Oh, right. Yeah. Anyway, sorry, go ahead, Jen.
Where was that?
It's a big base out in Maryland near D.C.
Oh, yeah. I just think different things go on in the dumb areas. Brian, I sure hope you don't have to go anywhere. You get to stay with your family and not have to go to Georgia.
Nah, the odds of them doing that is slim, but I was talking to Mark last week. It's still one of those things on the books.
Yeah.
You know, military is shorthanded. They call in whoever they can.
I wouldn't put cash money that you wouldn't go, you know,
no.
given your skill. And the fact, again, you're still walking around. It'd be different, you know, if you were missing a few things.
Well, when I get my tractor, maybe I'll lose a leg or something.
Go ahead, Jen.
And Karen, this interest that you had, like I think you went to Hungary and all this stuff that you know that they do these tests, have you always mm-hmm. been interested in that kind of, you know, well, what would you call them, scientific experiments? And obviously not with flat Earth, but... Have you always had a yen for that?
Well, yeah. I mean, I really liked science when I was in school. I mean, I didn't go to college for science or anything, but I always really liked it. And I was kind of a big nerd in the space thing, you know, like I watched a lot of those space documentaries and I used to even read a lot about it. I spent so much time crap, you know, like Discovery magazine before it was a channel, it was a magazine. There was like Omni and Science magazine and like stuff like that that I used to read. And so I was kind of into that stuff. And so, yeah, when I found out this place was something totally different, kind of blew my mind. And then I became like even more so interested in that than before now. You know, because I think that what the world really is or what it could, you know, I mean, we don't really know, but it's way cooler than what they've been telling us.
Well, you're not only sexy, but you're bright, too. That's pretty cool. Well, thank you very much, Mark. And I guess we'll see you next week, right?
We'll be here next week. We're going to keep broadcasting until, well, I start glowing in the dark. And even then. Probably just, you know, use less lights. All right. Thank you, Jen. Talk to you soon. Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Jan.
Let's go on the road to 504. Are you driving a truck right now?
Yes, I am. How's it going?
Where are you?
Same route as always. I'm in Oregon, I-5 North, about to... Well, I'm still on the phone, probably turn on to 205, and in the middle of it later tonight, about 11, I'll head all the way up to Chehalis, but I won't make it to Whidbey Island.
Okay. what's going on, yeah?
I got a couple things that both related to what you guys are talking about, making that turn on to 205 right now. The first one I'll say, the second one I was about the underground military bases and stuff and weapons of mass destruction. But I wanted to ask about the war. You got the emails I sent you. I sent you a couple within the past 2 or 3 weeks And in the most recent one, I sent you links to excerpts of a couple books that came out by a Russian military analyst. He's his name is Andrei Martyanov. These books came out in 2018 and 2019. He's a naturalized American. But anyway, the title of the book from 2018, it's entitled Losing Military Supremacy. And long story short, both books argue that Russia's military affairs in particular, alongside other things like their economy, but their military has improved over time, such as that now, he argues in these books, in an outright war, Russia would defeat the United States militarily, totally aside from the Chinese factor.
It's always a possibility, but go ahead.
I can't comment on that detail because I've got them ordered myself. I just ran across that, but I'll have them myself by this weekend. But Andrei Martyanov, if anybody wants to check that out, his last name is spelled Martyanov. I think he's conservative, but he's a naturalized American. I think he came over in the mid-90s, like when a lot of Russians did, but he's apparently he likes Putin like a lot of us do. But moving on, I wanted to, the other thing that I sent you, I mentioned it's kind of dated now, but there was a book came out back in the, like around 1986 or so, back in the 80s. It's called Nuclear Battlefields by William Arkin, and the book is a layout of the entire nuclear weapons industry, from tells the locations where they're manufactured, all the bases, everything, just lays it out bare. And sure. The other thing I sent you was an update of that. It's there's a short, compared to a whole book, an article in the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientist. It's just recently, like within the past month. And I just, FYI, the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientist was founded in 1945 by former Manhattan Project scientists who tend to be slightly left-leaning on the political scale. The Manhattan Project himself, its name was changed to the Atomic Energy Commission, which was founded in that year, 1945. But anyway, this article, it lays out, this is what I want to say about the, it has a map of the United States, and it shows what the military arsenal is. Three sectors: the submarine-based weapons of mass destruction, and those are mainly in two bases, in ballistic missile submarine-based Trident bases. That's in Kings Bay, Georgia, and the other one is Kitsap, or Silverdale, Washington, which you mentioned earlier. It's right. I used to be stationed there myself. And
Kitsap is not that far from me. Yeah, I know. Dennis, go to the, I hate to do this to you, but it is a call-in show. Talk about the dumb bases for like 60 seconds, then I got to let you go, okay?
Okay, sure thing. Yeah, that was the next thing I was going to say. There's three main areas where the land-based ballistic missiles are located in the United States. That's central Montana, central North Dakota, and southeast Wyoming, on the line a little bit. That borders into northeast Colorado and far west Nebraska. But that's where they have underground missile groups, clusters of underground ballistic missiles aimed at the Russia and whatnot. The others are deployed by airplanes, their own Air Force bases.
Gotcha.
Anyway, but
thank you, Dennis, for all that. And again, we'll keep you posted, and hopefully things will progress into next week.
We'll see you.
All right. Have a good one. All right. Let's pick up and tie a bow on this one. Let's grab 845 out of New York. Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it with Truth Smax, Trail Mix Supreme.
New York, New York. This place fucking sucks. I got to get out of here. Oh, my God. This is not the place to be when World War III starts. Hey, Karen. Hey, Mark. Hey, Brian.
I think you're actually a safer place than me. Because, like Dennis was just saying, there's only the two main... dumb luck. The two main sub-bases... One of them is right down the road from here.
Right by you.
Right. That's, I mean, it's close enough, depending on if we're talking, well, we'll see. But
I think you're right. I think Lex Luthor had the right plan. Blow up the San Andreas Fault with a nuke in fucking St. California.
Lex Luthor, which I love, gold is gold. He goes, men are no damn good. He goes, but land, that's the one thing they're not making any more of. Yep. So,
nope.
Yeah.
Nope.
Anyway.
Yeah, I agree with you guys. It's retarded. It's definitely going to be the PetroRuble, the Petro something, the Petro Shekel or something else, and they're going to fuck with us, no doubt.
Shekel.
And it's just like, yeah, the Shekel. Might as well be. Right, the Zionist, right? Isn't that the Israeli money?
Yes, that is the Israeli money.
Yeah,
yes.
Like you said, it's totally by plan. Now they're saying, would you say that, it's our fault because we backed Ukraine and now we've started a financial... Get the fuck out of here, you morons. It's all by design. Yeah, you know? And somebody I know, you guys know, just got orders for a year. Why? He's leaving next week. What the fuck? I was like, do you mean? A year. Yeah. Yeah. I'll tell you later in after hours. I was like, Brian might actually be going to work.
This is, I mean, the rules of high school fights transition over to world politics very, very well, which is you get the two biggest kids and then you start, you know, you get some instigator in there. It's like, yeah, did you see what he did? He just beat up one of your best friends. Yeah, he's not really my, but he totally did, you know. And then you back that guy.
You're
and the next thing
that?
You know, you got two guys standing
walking in the street, snapping your fingers.
Yeah, exactly. Snapping your fingers and the music cues in. Yeah. If you guys have never seen the original West Side Story, I highly recommend it. You will enjoy what America used to be back when. Oh, God. When gang fights were musicals. Yeah.
Right. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But it sucks because I didn't want to be with the Puerto Ricans. They suck.
Go crazy.
I didn't want to be with them. Fuck them. I wanted to be with the white kids. And they were like, no.
Oh, God.
Well, every time we played West Side Story, I was the only Puerto Rican, so they always wanted to knife me. I'm like, you guys suck.
You know what? For Americans, though, it's got to be some, you know, for people, the Gen Xers, you know, growing up with how many movies and television shows, it's like, oh, the freaking Russians. And now.
Oh, yeah, the Cold War, right.
Look at that. And actually, there's a line from Red Dawn, the original Red Dawn, when the pilot was talking to him, the kids were asking him why. It's like, why is this happening? And it was very simple, and I can't quote it verbatim. I'll have to look it up afterwards, where he goes, who knows? You know, two biggest kids on the block, sooner or later, they were going to fight. So, yeah. And that was the line. That was all he had to use to justify it. So, but in that movie, the Chinese backed us. I don't see that happening.
A million of them.
No.
Right. Yeah, back when there was only 900 million Chinese.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. There's a billion of them. Not anymore.
Yeah, which made China. Yeah.
I got a quote.
But
two armies, large armies. And I like that because I'm not saying, like, I don't knock any of the military guys that are in, been there, thinking, you know, doing the right thing, patriotism, all that, my brother, the whole nine. But it's always doing it for some fucking banker, some suit, something, someone else. Yeah. So it is. They're dying for nothing, for lines on a map that don't exist in reality. You know what I mean? So that's what I picked up.
It is man's nature, not necessarily women's. God bless them, but men's definitely. All right. Hey, shout outs real quick because we're going to music. So what do you got?
Shout out to Master Gunner, Mark Sargent, Karen B, Zulu One, everyone out in the chat, community, the world, and fuck the mask holes in New York. Sucks here. These people are morons. So stupid.
Right on. With that, we will be here next week. Same flat time, same flat channel. Say goodnight, Karen.
Good night, Karen, and I'm sorry for everybody who's watching my stream and it crashed. I don't know what happened.
It's the NSA. Otherwise known as the Iranians. Say goodnight, Zulu.
Good night, Zulu.
Say goodnight, Master Gunner.
Nuclear sex.
With that, hot sex.
Hot sex.
Good night, everybody.
What you'll ever need.